Ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to the 91st Annual General Meeting of FICCI. Please give a hand to the eminent parliamentarians as they walk up. We begin this session, we begin our celebrations with a very, very significant session. A panel session with eminent members of the parliament from across political spectrum to dwell on the elements and building blocks of New India, which is the theme of our AGM.
You started with an oxymoron. Eminence and parliamentarians don't go together.
In conversation with the parliamentarians would be Ms. Sangita Reddy, Vice President FICCI and Joint Managing Director, Apollo Hospitals Group. But before we start, we will welcome the panelists in FICCI's ecological style of presenting green certificates, a pledge by FICCI to plant 5 trees in the name of each panelist at the periphery of Sundarban National Park. So may I request Ms. Sangita Reddy to do the honors. A certificate for Shri Dinesh Trivedi, Member of the Parliament from West Bengal representing All India Trinamool Congress Party in Lok Sabha. Former Union Minister and eminent parliamentarians who have served both terms in the Rajya Sabha as well as Lok Sabha since 1990. A certificate for Shri Pinaki Misra, a 3-time elected Member of Parliament from Odisha representing Biju Janata Dal in Lok Sabha. A senior advocate of the Supreme Court, whose roots are in politics, and someone who comes from a family of jurists. A certificate for Shri AnuragSinghThakur, again a 3-time elected member of the parliament from Himachal Pradesh, Lok Sabha, appointed the chief whip of BJP in the Lok Sabha and the youngest to assume the post. A certificate for Professor Rajiv Gowda, an eminent professor and now a member of the parliament from Karnataka, representing Indian National Congress Party. A certificate for Shrimati Geetha Kothapalli, member of parliament from Lok Sabha, representing the Jana, Jagruti party from Andhra Pradesh. Over to Ms. Sangita Reddy to start the session.
Start from here and then move. Thank you. President FICCI, Mr. Rashesh Shah, let me start off by congratulating you on an outstanding year. And I think this is the... To all our past presidents who continue to guide us and inspire everyone who's trying to do something special for this organization, members, ladies and gentlemen, and most importantly and significantly, our panelists, our members of parliament, our people's representatives, people who we are looking up to for today's really special session. Mao Zedong, the great Chinese leader, once famously said that there is disorder under heaven, yet the situation is excellent. The first part is an apt description of the domestic political landscape in India and the global geopolitical realignments. The second part is an utopian view of how foreign business and investors should view the country in the backdrop of a number of efforts being made, undertaken both by the central and the state governments to woo them, from invest in Gujarat to vibrant Gujarat to invest in Orissa. Every state says we are the best, come to us, really leading a very special environment. Between now and 2030, under the normal election 5-year cycle, we will see 3 changes of government at the center, or 3 cycles, maybe someone will be re-elected. But the broader agenda of India's long-term sustainable development will remain the same. At the state level too, it will become clear that an aspirational young politician, an aspirational young population will now demand 3 major things. economic progress, jobs, and delivery of basic facilities. Having said that, it would indeed be an Herculean task in an atmosphere mired in political rhetoric and the tenets of model democracy being severely tested. But then, we're used to seeing it all. We're used to an integrated democracy. To dispel the environment of distrust and acrimony, it is imperative for business and government to come together, to diffuse occasionally the disillusionment, but more importantly, to create the positivity that we need for the India of tomorrow, and to drive this disenchantment and create paths of working together. The India of today, and in order to envision and eventually to articulate and then to create and facilitate, and as Dinesh Ji said, to start working on it from today itself. To look at this, and that we'll say at the end. We need nimble-footedness in identifying these changes in an ever-evolving world. What we used to know of the world when we grew up, what we learnt of the world when we were educated, what has become of the world as we got into business, and what will become of the world as we move on and hand over mantles to next generation, each one is a completely different paradigm. And it is in this changing paradigm that we ask the question, yet rooted as we are as a country, in history, in social values, in caste systems, in diversity, and yet in unity, what is the nature of society and where is the future India? It's to this that we look upon our venerable panelists, our representatives. So I would request each of the panelists to first present briefly in 3 to 5 minutes your vision for a new India. How will you reduce agri-stress? Is it farm waivers, which is taking 40,000 crores or 1% of our GDP? Or will you think of something new? Can we look at a futures market? Can we look at MSP? Can we change to small farming to major? What are you thinking of jobs? Will the jobless growth of the world's economy be something different in India? What is your focus on MSME? What is women's empowerment? What are we going to do about the fact that everybody has something to say about GST? Where is policy? Where is implementation? Where is social infrastructure? Where is unity in our diversity? And when do we transcend political lines to become a country together? These are some of the things that we will be asking you. So after your 5 minutes, I will then do a quick round of questions, and then we'll actually throw the questions open to the audience. So thank you all so much for your time. Thanks for being here, and welcome to a truly interesting and exciting visionary session on the future of India. May I please request our most senior parliamentarian, Shri Dinesh Trivedi, to please start with your 5 minutes. You can sit there or use the podium, whatever you want. Please come, let's give him a big hand.
Sangita, senior, I'm sure in experience, not necessary in age. And thank you, Sangita, thank you so very much. 91st AGM, all my best wishes. It's not very easy to cross this huge 91st milestone. So my compliments to FICCI and their members. I was just on a lighter note telling Sangita that in the next hour and 15 minutes, we are all going to spread our vision of India for tomorrow, and you all are going to implement it. And I said, your time starts now. I said, that is the condition on which I'm going to speak. In all seriousness, 5 minutes of FICCI and 5 minutes of Parliament, they are two different, so we will be somewhere in between that. I will try my best to limit myself in 5 minutes. Please shout, ring bell, whatever you want to do. But that 5 minutes starts now. Vision of India. Now, if you really want to talk about the vision of India or your family or your business or whatever it is, you need to understand India. Without understanding India, I don't think so you can even think about the vision of India. The other day I had some about 30, 40 very senior director level of Boeing company all over the world. They came into India, and the senior president of Boeing company in India, Pratt, who's a good friend of mine, and he said, Dinesh, why don't you give them a talk? I said, good enough. So the podium was like this. They were sitting in front of me. And I said, you guys, most welcome to India. We are very happy that you are here. But please tell me what brings you to India. And one of the person who was moderating, he said that, sir, they have come to India to know something about India. So in a dramatic way, I leave the podium and go and sit with them. And they say, what has happened? I said, I also want to know something about India. It's a complex country. And in order to have the vision, the first thing, know your country. And whether you start with Swami Vivekananda or Kovi Guru Rabindranath Tagore, their vision, if you go back to Vivekananda, he talks about arise awake, and till time your vision is reached, be at it. If you talk about Guru Rabindranath Tagore, he says, where the mind is without fear and the head is held high. Today, unfortunately, maybe, I may be wrong, but the head is somewhere, I don't know, in the gutter or wherever, and leave aside holding it high, it's somewhere else but not holding it high. So I personally feel, in order to understand the vision of India, as Vivekananda talked about, India's strength, what is India's strength? India's strength, as I feel, is twofold. Number one, knowledge. I have never considered Hinduism as a religion. It's a science of knowledge. And this is what spirituality is all about. So we are the best as far as knowledge is concerned. And this century belongs to knowledge. Second thing, we are very good farmers. 70% of India still lives in farm. So combining these two, I think first of all, we have to understand that this is it. Sangita, the new world order is being designed, or the world, let's say, is redesigned. And this world is redesigned by Indians. And I'm sure all of us are aware of it. But unfortunately, these Indians who are redesigned in the world, they are not in India. They are in Palo Alto. They are in Silicon Valley. They are the ones who are really redesigning. So please understand the strength of India is knowledge. Today, the war between America and China, it's not the war of how much you are manufacturing, how much we are manufacturing. The war is of chips. And if the strength of America is there, the strength comes from the university. Again, knowledge. We have somewhere down the line left our knowledge somewhere else, and we are just trying to imitate somebody else. To kehte na kauwa chala hans ki chaal, aakhir bhula apni chaal. Often we compare ourselves with China. Please understand, 70 years back, both these countries started together. If China is somewhere else today, and if we are somewhere else, there is something maybe they are doing right, and there is something which we are not doing right. In spite of this bank of knowledge, and I personally feel there is no happiness in just saying, oh, China is not a democracy. It doesn't matter. But the fact is, today, if there are five important countries in the world, people definitely look at China. I have just no doubt about it, that India's vision can never, ever, ever be achieved without understanding the strength of India. And I personally feel people sitting right in front of me and us are full of knowledge. All we have to make sure is that unleash their knowledge. Live them the freedom which we always talk about. Let's go back to the days of Upanishad, where we question the existence of God as well. Certainly, if we go back, things will fall in place, and I have no doubt about it that this is one of the greatest country, Sone ki Chidiya, we can achieve, and I'm sure all us put together, we have to change our narratives from negativity to positive. Today, the impression is everybody is chore, which is not true. We have a lot of strength. We can really make sure that we are the beacon. People look at us, and that is why the respect of India and Indians. Thank you very much, Sangita, for having me here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dineshji. The strength of your knowledge is the power of your vision for India. And thank you. May I now request Pinaki Misra? He's a very well-known parliamentarian representing Odisha, and he's stated to have a tremendous interest in women and youth. We look forward to hearing your vision.
I hope you take that in the right spirit. These are dangerous times to utter these words loosely and lightly. My very good friends who've very kindly invited us here, Arun Chawla was my classmate from school, and of course, Mrs. Sangita Reddy, who I've known forever almost, and whose husband is a distinguished member of parliament and my colleague in parliament, and all the other distinguished parliamentarians here. Again, I say distinguished, and that has to be qualified. When Arun said eminent parliamentarians, I said you started on an oxymoron, because if you look at television every morning at 11, when question hour begins, I'm not sure the qualification distinguished or eminent would suit parliamentarians in India. Unfortunate, but that's the sad truth. And that's really what I want to begin with. Mr. Dinesh Trivedi, my very dear friend, has struck a very philosophical note full of wonderful quotes and aphorisms, and that's all very well in the abstract. I'm slightly more brass tacks in my approach to life and to problems. And which is why I'm saddened to have to say that India today really represents, you know, what France represented during the French Revolution in the latter half of the 18th century. And the French then had a saying, the more things change, more they remain the same. Unfortunately, that's the truism that obtains in India today. The more things change, we find, the more they remain the same. 5 years back, I think when the present government took over, I think there was an extraordinary amount of optimism with which they took over. And I think it was unthinkable that the kind of results we've had 2 days back could have been foreseen 5 years back when the present government took oath. Something has gone wrong. I'm not going to say that this is paradise lost. I'm not going to be political about this. I think when we are talking, the leitmotif tonight, today here, is building a new India. And I think if you're building a new India, you're envisioning building a new India, then you really have to be bipartisan. You cannot be cocooned in your own isms and hope to build a new India. There is just too much going in this country with, as we say, a 450 million middle class. When the whole world is looking towards us, it's inconceivable that we should not be bipartisan and think about how this country is to be taken forward. That spirit is sadly missing in parliament. We are all guilty. The Biju Janata Dal, the party I belong to, less so than the others, because we have tried never to be obstreperous and to obstruct parliament. But in a sense, on a sort of spiritual level, I think we are all guilty of not adhering to the spirit of bipartisanship by which all of us can kindle that growth together. And that's one of the sad things that one has to lament about. FICCI has done us the favor of giving us, you know, a sort of a, like a timetable or a template forward, which consists of 10 must-do, have-to-do things as far as the Indian polity is concerned. These are unexceptionable. I don't think anybody can have a cavil as far as these are concerned. They relate to health, education, water and sanitation. They relate to agriculture, strategic trade and industrial policy, travel, tourism, finance for growth, labor and land reforms, infrastructure and logistics, cluster development and urbanization, maximizing governance in terms of administrative, regulatory and judicial reform, and of course, minimizing government and destigmatizing capitalism. I think all these 10 templates were something that this government, the present government, came to power on. I can't think of a single one of these templates that this government did not harp upon and that the people did not believe that this government would be at least attempting to deliver. Instead, and I again don't want to be politically partisan about this, but instead what we have, particularly north of India, is this extraordinary sight which happened about 10 days back of a policeman lying dead upside down in his jeep for the world to see as to what has happened to the rule of law in this country. So therefore, there is no fear of the rule of law. Forget about building a robust judicial system. Forget about building a robust society where the rule of law must necessarily obtain. Today, you have a policeman butchered in the name of cow slaughter, cow vigilantism, for the world to see. And I think nothing depicts a more dismal picture of India than that. I was distraught that somebody in uniform should be lying in his own jeep upside down, you know, virtually like a slaughtered cattle. This is for all of us to reflect as to where we have gone wrong, as to why we have reached this pass where the agrarian economy has taken such a massive hit because of these sort of issues that have come to the forefront, because of the 10 templates that this government wished to bring to light, that wished to take forward, that it did not concentrate and focus on, as a result of which now these electoral reverses have come, as a result of which there is now no appetite for further legislation. Clearly, this parliament now, there is no appetite for legislation. You will see no legislation going forward. Government has been ruling for the last 6 months by ordinance route, and the government will continue to rule for the next 2 months until the model code of conduct kicks in by the ordinance route. That's not a happy situation. It is for all of us to sit down and reflect as to where we have gone wrong. In building a new India, we have to carve out a new path. The path that we have trodden thus far, I don't think is the path that will carry us to a $9 trillion economy that FICCI here is sitting and dreaming about. Ladies and gentlemen, whatever my party has to do towards that end, we are ready. Many of you have just told me that you went to the Make in Orissa conclave, which was a roaring success. You've seen what Orissa can do as a so-called backward state, with the World Cup hockey being played there, world-class infrastructure suddenly in place. Every commentator, my heart fills with joy, it swells with joy when I hear every commentator and every international ex-player come on television and say, we have never seen infrastructure like this. And this morning, I was speaking to Mr. Jaitley, and he was gracious enough to say, you know, this is the soft power that you must ask Chief Minister to take forward. I'm going to personally speak to him, ensure that like the Barbati Stadium is for cricket, like the Kalinga Stadium is for hockey, we must now have world-class infrastructure for football, so that what Hyderabad did for badminton, Orissa should be able to do for a number of other sports. I'm grateful to the Finance Minister for his bipartisanship, and this is what is expected in our polity. Ladies and gentlemen, I certainly hope India is out of the World Cup, but I certainly hope some of you will be able to come to Orissa, watch the semi-finals and the finals, because it's going to be a glorious spectacle. And with that, I hope other states take up, you know, this sort of spirit, in the right spirit. Thank you very much for having me here. If I have sounded slightly pessimistic, you will forgive me. But you will agree that, you know, the harshness, the glare of the harshness and the light must be seen in the right light. Even if the glass is half dark, it must be watched. That's what Shakespeare said, right? We must not shy away. Thank you very much for inviting me. All the very best.
Thank you, Pinaki ji. That was really, you know, inspirational in a way for you to accept the fact that we need more bipartisan. I'm so happy to introduce Shri Anurag Thakur. Anurag is a three-time elected Member of Parliament from Himachal Pradesh, and we must acknowledge the fact that not only is he the chief whip of his party, but he's also the youngest to assume this post. Thank you, Anurag.
Thank you, Sangita ji. Good afternoon, everyone. I don't want to use this stage to criticize anyone, because this is about building a new India. And youth being the largest stakeholder, youth has to play an important role in the nation building process. New India is not mere a vision or a statement or aspiration. It's a work in progress. As Prime Minister Modi said, New India will have the foundation of three C's. It will be free of casteism, communalism, and corruption. If you ask me, I'll say, I agree with Modi ji, but my vision for New India will be having these foundations of three E's and three M's, which is education, employment, empowerment. And I think to have a knowledgeable society, it's very important to have a good quality education system. And I think that will lead to the overall employment and empowerment of the 1.3 billion Indians. And why I say the three M's, which is mobile, mobility, and modernization. In the 21st century, we have seen how the technology has played an important role. We have seen the time when we used to apply for a landline connection from there to a mobile phone, where the balance sheets of the telecom service providers used to show revenue mainly from the voice. It has shifted to data. With millions of Indians using the mobile phones, and the technology is going to play an important role, I believe this mobile cellular connectivity will be very, very important, especially for the rural India. When we can look at the e-healthcare, e-education, for the farm sector, e-NAM, which is the e-National Agriculture Marketplace, to help our farmers to get better prices. And with the Digital India program, we are reaching out to 2.5 lakh panchayats. Wi-Fi will be on in the next few months. And we can surely look at these facilities at the grassroots level. And when I talk about mobility in India, it's not easy to provide transportation to 1.3 billion Indians. Public transport has to be good. And if we have to be a global player, not only for the public transport, but also for the ferry of goods, whether it is through water, rail, or road connectivity. And I'm glad that our government, in the last 4.5 years, have been able to achieve at least twice than the previous government, whether it is the building of roads or rail infrastructure, or overall, as far as the waterways are concerned, we have taken enough steps in that direction. Sangita ji, you touched upon the farming sector as well, and modernization not only in the industry, but we need modern farms and agriculture technologies as well, so that we can have more crops per drop. That should be the key, so that our farmers should earn more and more and should also feed 1.3 billion Indians. I think it's important for me to highlight the achievement of the governments here, but I won't stick to that because I may have 10 different platforms to do so. I personally feel we have, in the federal structure, look after the interest of each and every state. And we have been saying it from the day one, cooperative federalism, where every state has to play an important role in the overall development of this country. Whether Odisha has done well, Madhya Pradesh has done well, or any other state has done well, I would like to thank each and every state. It is their responsibility, that is why they have been elected to perform. But if you go 4.5 years back, when most of the papers used to write about the policy paralysis and the corruption. Now today, after 4.5 years, if we say from indecisiveness to the decisive government, कि पहले तो निर्णय नहीं हो पाता था, अब होता है तो कड़े निर्णय भी लेते हैं. So we have to decide what we want. And if I have to go for the achievements, if there used to be only limited number of people who used to file returns and pay taxes, it has doubled in less than 2 years, which we could not achieve in last 70 years. It is not only the burden on you, but many others have started sharing that. And I'm proud to say here, if you look at the agriculture produce also, that has also increased. If you look at the rights of Muslim women, we have tried to provide that. When we talk about the parliament, we have on the day one, I still remember on the day one, when Captain Amarinder Singh in the Lok Sabha said, we want a debate on inflation, price rise. Maine kaha, sir, abhi to sarkar bane do din nahi hue, mehngai ki charcha hame kyun karni pade. But we are open to do so. Even now, you look at the CPI and WPI, it is the lowest. If you look at the current account deficit, it is well under control. We are ready to debate each and every issue, but that should be done in the parliament. I personally feel we may have to fight among each other to be in power, but the ultimate goal should be for a stronger India, the foundation for the stronger India. हमारी लड़ाई आपस की नहीं, हमें दुनिया से लड़ने की बात है. तो उसके लिए इकट्ठे मिलकर लड़ना पड़ेगा. और जब मिलेनियम डेवलपमेंट, when we used to talk about millennium development goal in those 10-15 years, we discussed it only once at the fag end of it. Now we talk about the sustainable development goals. We discussed only one part of it, which is the healthcare sector. I think we should have more deliberations in the parliament. Any government should be held accountable for which they have been elected. As a young member, I wanted to say, and I wanted to tell you something. Ek bar ek bahut bade raja ne bahut sare rajyon ko jeetne ke baad, ladai ke baad, apne jyotishi ke paas baith ke kaha, mera haath dekho ki mera bhavishya kya kehta hai. तो ज्योतिष ने हाथ देकर कहा, भाई आपकी तो यहाँ पे लकीर ही नहीं महाराज, माफ करिए, आपके हाथ में भाग्य रेखा ही नहीं है. तो उसने सोचा कि मैंने इतने राज्य जीत लिए और मेरे हाथ में भाग्य रेखा ही नहीं है. उसने अपनी कटार निकाली और लंबी सी लकीर हाथ के ऊपर खींच दी और कहा, अब देखकर बताओ कि मेरा भाग्य क्या कहता है. उसने कहा, जो अपने भाग्य की रेखा खुद लिखने वाला हो, उसका भाग्य कैसा होगा इसे मुझे कहने की आवश्यकता नहीं. और आज के भारत की भाग्य रेखा हमें स्वयं लिखनी है, स्वयं खींचनी है, स्वयं आगे बढ़ानी है. एंड व्हाट मिस्टर त्रिवेदी सेड इन द इनिशियली ही कोटेड विवेकानंदा बाय सेइंग, अराइज अवेक नॉट स्टॉल अंटिल द गोल इज अचीव्ड. उठो जागो रुको मत जब तक मंजिल प्राप्त ना हो जाए. मैं आप सबसे भी यही कहना चाहता हूँ, 21वीं शताब्दी के भारत को बनाने के लिए हम तब तक नहीं रुकेंगे जब तक हम वहाँ पर नहीं पहुँच जाएँ. And why I'm saying so is, if you look at the artificial intelligence, I think which by 2030 will add close to 17% to the GDP. And out of those $14 trillion, if China is bound to take away close to 7 trillion, is India aiming to have at least 1 trillion or 1.5 trillion? Are we having enough investment into that sector? I think with the startups, we could see a lot of number of startups coming in the tier 2 cities and the smaller towns. We could see the companies like Biju, Flipkart, Ola, Paytm, having billions of dollars valuation. I think we have started in the right direction and we can achieve much more. I just want to thank FICCI for giving me some time and opportunity to speak here. I seek your support to making a not only a new India, but a much stronger, wealthier, healthier, happier India. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anurag. That was truly inspirational. Our next speaker, Shri Rajiv Gowdaji, we request you to take the podium. You, of course, need no introduction, but Professor Gowda was actually appointed the AICC national spokesperson and has a tremendous political career, which he anchors in his deep knowledge, being a professor himself.
Thank you, Sangita, for that generous introduction, and good afternoon, every one of you. If you're thinking about our vision of New India, it would be a healthy, happy, harmonious, humane, hugely successful Hindustan. What do I mean by this? I want to emphasize some of the terms that I've just mentioned here. Words like humane, harmonious, these are words that are somehow lacking in the country in the last few years. And that's something that we'll bring back to the table, ensure that those ideals that are there in our preamble, the one about fraternity, which people may not understand what that means, it means that we all live together in happiness and peace. All of us. Anyway, let me talk about the kinds of challenges that we face to achieve this particular goal. One of the biggest challenges before us is the transition from rural to urban India. And what we do in response to this, how we address the pain of rural India, how we address the challenges of creating new cities, managing the cities that we already have in a better manner. These managing the migration that India is already witnessing and that will result in all kinds of challenges between cultures that coexist. These are part of our challenges going forward. How do we manage the environment? When I say harmonious, I also mean, are we living in harmony with nature? Because climate change is on the horizon. We're already seeing disasters of a magnitude that we haven't in different parts of the country. And we need to learn to proactively preempt these kinds of disasters by changing our practices. By that, I mean not just government, I mean every citizen, every industry that's represented here as well. What about other challenges? Well, when we think about environment, we are resting our hope in technology. Our hope is that we will make some dramatic transitions, that we will leapfrog over our coal reserves and harness instead our renewable energy sources, of which we have in abundance, that we will find a way to harvest the water that we get to ensure that we don't go through these cycles of of lack and scarcity and excess at other times. During all this, we have to pay attention to inclusion. And this is something that's a very, very central part of our vision. And when I say inclusion, I mean inclusion on the economic front of the poor who are left behind by the market economy, of women who are not necessarily finding an equal space at the table, of people of different backgrounds, people from rural India. Inclusion is very, very central to that mission, to that larger vision. Because until and every Indian believes that the country that's emerging is one where they all have a chance, we are letting people down. And education is the other major transformative potential that we have. We keep talking about the demographic dividend, the fact that we're one of the world's youngest nations. We've got a few hundred million youngsters below the age of 35, more than half the population. At the same time, we have a demography on the other end of people who are aging, and we need to address their challenges as well, because we will see problems arising with regard to the problems of old age, dementia, and various other things, social security for the aged. But coming back to education, if you can somehow again hope that technology will make a difference, that we'll find a way to level the playing field and create that equality of access to knowledge and equality of access to opportunity, if we're going to be able to make that happen again, then we will be able to build this harmonious, inclusive India. But our vision of knowledge, to build on Dineshji's point and on the points that everyone else has also broadly come up with, you know, we are actually underperforming on the global stage. If you think about India and our potential when it comes to education, all you got to do is think of the word Vishwavidyalaya and translate that. It essentially means education hub of the world. We are not at this moment serving our own people, but the real vision is one where we can actually open our doors, and instead of going to the Harvards and the Oxfords, people will come to India, where you can get a high quality education in the English language at probably an extraordinarily low cost. But we haven't gone there yet. But that's something that we will also work towards. And another feature that we must emphasize is strengthening and maintaining institutions. You know, people, I did not want to bring up political points here at all, but my colleagues have shown me the way. You know, I will actually desist, but point out that it's extremely important that every institution that's out there, whether the Supreme Court, whether the Reserve Bank of India, whether the investigative agencies, every one of them has to be strengthened to do their job without being subverted for other partisan ends. And ultimately, where are we going to go with this vision of a harmonious India? You know, we need to ensure that our markets can also be unleashed. The same way I talked about education, India needs to be a market which is, you know, which does amazingly well for every Indian, but also where each and every one of you can conquer global markets as well. So that's the kind of India that maybe technology, maybe innovation, maybe the experience of serving a very frugal market in some ways, that will give us that capability to go out and conquer global markets, that e-commerce and other new platforms that are emerging will level the playing field and let everyone in the country access the same goods and services that were so far available only to the wealthy in urban India. So ultimately, our aim is to unleash India's human capital, and for that, health is another. Our chairperson here, a moderator, Sangita Reddy, will tell you that health is a domain where we really have a tremendous distance to travel. We are still quite behind on numerous crucial indicators, such as maternal and infant mortality. But going forward, we are looking at epidemics of non-communicable diseases, lifestyle diseases, obesity, diabetes, blood pressure, heart disease, things like that. And there's so much that we need to do to change our culture. We need to not just follow yoga, but we probably need to be a culture that's out there jogging every morning across the country. Something that, you know, changing the way we eat and focus on nutritious, locally grown products. So basically, there's a tremendous distance to travel. But as long as we keep that vision of a healthy, happy, harmonious, humane, and hugely successful Hindustan, I think together we can get there in our lifetimes and show the rest of the world what we're capable of. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajivji. It was indeed the depth of knowledge combined with the power of your vision. I have great pleasure in introducing a young, dynamic member of parliament who's a woman. So Srimati Geetha Kothapalli, who not only believes in what she says, but she actions it out. So she has now started her own political party, Jana Jagruti Party in Andhra Pradesh, and intends to fight the elections through her party in Andhra Pradesh in every single parliamentary seat that she has. So, and she will be the first one to implement 33% reservation for women in her own party. So Geetha, great to have you. Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Sangita ji. Good evening to all of you. First of all, I would like to congratulate you all on this 91st annual general meeting for going so far. And I congratulate FICCI for having engaging with parliamentarians in a dialogue regularly on different issues. My colleagues, my honorable colleagues have spoken everything. There's nothing much left for me to speak, but I want to emphasize on a new India which I have been dreaming of for the past few decades. The new India, when we talk about the preamble, we say of the people, by the people, for the people. It's very easy for us to pronounce those words. But in reality, do we think that it is happening? Except for the oath that we cast every 5 years, are we making our representatives responsible, accountable? Are we able to question them? Are we seeing what is happening behind the oath or the vote bank politics? Are we ensuring transparency of the schemes? India is a federal structure. State-central relations are very important in implementation of the schemes. But in true sense, in true democratic sense, are the schemes being grounded with the same vision that they have been formulated? I don't think so. That is because the governance is not people-centric. I feel that the people are the major agents for the change. It's not the politicians. So my emphasis is always when I talk about politics, I keep telling, unless and until a politician is made accountable for his deeds and actions, we can never see the vision of New India. I feel it should be 100% involvement of the citizens. Only a citizen-centric governance can bring in the change as we all dream. I feel the local governance, the local bodies, the strengthening of the gram panchayats is a very important step for us towards marching towards the modern India. And the second important thing I feel is, as my colleague Rajivji and Ranragji rightly said, the education. Recently, all of us were traveling to US, and I have spent time with some of my Telugu people in US. When I was talking about my new party, the people in US said, "Madam, please don't talk about anything. Just give proper education to the people of the country." I feel the quality of education is drastically down at the present scenario. When we studied at 8th standard, today I feel that even a person who has finished his post-graduation is not able to draft a proper leave letter. That is the position, quality of education that we are imparting. Is it right? So we have been failing in providing quality education to the citizens of the country. And teachers nowadays, what I have seen is they have been made to work like multi-purpose workers attending to all other duties rather than just teaching. So I feel that the system of education should change. The quality of education should increase. The government policies should concentrate on providing education to the citizens of the country, not just ordinary education, if I say. It says the quality education, we have to ensure that quality education should be given to the children. And the second thing is the health amenities. I come from a very, very rural constituency. It is a tribal constituency. And of late, maybe many of you would have seen on the televisions four people carrying a pregnant woman from the villages. After 70 years of independence, if this is the scenario, what is it that we are talking about the new India? Yes, I do agree. We have made a lot of progress. But still, when we are still fighting for the minimum amenities and we talk about satellites, so I feel that what is important has to be prioritized. the government should prioritize what is the minimum requirement, what is the minimum requirement of the citizens to have a peaceful and progressive life, rather than it is very, very important today in the today's scenario. We have been seeing in the elections, many people keep saying unemployment allowance. One says 3,000, the other says 3,036 rupees. I don't understand, because we have 12 million youth joining the every year, multiplying till 2020. We have a great advantage of the demographic dividend. But today I feel demographic dividend, whatever we have, is not an advantage, is a challenge, is a biggest challenge. Are we going to make our youth irresponsible and lazy? Isn't it time we think that we engage the youth in different activities, create a sort of employment, and then pay them something, at least create a mandal level roster for the uneducated, unemployed youth, and engage them in some work rather than engaging the teachers and the other government employees. Let them do some job. Let them, don't create laziness in the youth, because the youth is the biggest strength of this nation. Let us not make this youth into lazy youth and make them irresponsible. So all of us have to join hands. All these things will only happen when the citizens are being aware. And agriculture, when we talk about the agriculture, yes, Sangita ji rightly said, are we talking about loan waivers or are we talking about something else? I feel just a loan waiver will not serve a purpose at all. Maybe, yes, there are some people who are actually suffering due to the bad agricultural produce, not only that, due to different calamities, I do agree. But when it comes to agriculture, agriculture is the backbone of our country, and almost 50% of the people are living on agriculture. So now it is time we make a corpus fund for agriculture and we create MSPs. We bring in new innovative technology into agriculture. It is not just the crop waivers, but innovation. Information technology should be brought into every field of life so that it will influence the individual to enter into the modernization and to have a better produce. I mean, as Anurag ji said, more crop per drop. So agriculture is also a very important aspect. And when I talk about all this, I should not forget the main aspect. If 50% of the population on this planet Earth, the women, are not being encouraged into politics, legislative bodies, or into the prime employment purposes, we are not talking about empowerment at all. If the women is not empowered, the nation can never be empowered. We have seen the workforce in India. Women are the lowest. Women are, I think, 122nd position we are having. So workforce, we are not involved into the workforce. And legislative bodies, I keep saying, women don't need reservation, women need space. Are the political parties ensuring that space for the women? As a woman today, I have decided that in my political party, I'm going to go up to 50%, 1/3 to 50%. I want to involve women into the legislative bodies because they understand the problems more than that anybody can tackle. And I feel that women should come forward, join hands for the change, and bring in the new India. I wish that everybody would stand by me and say that, yes, women are the prime force which will actually contribute in building a new India. Thank you so much. Jai Hind.
Thank you, Geetha. I think clearly let me say that FICCI will definitely stand by you. FICCI was the first to have a lady president. We've already had two women presidents of FICCI, and so we definitely stand by you in that fact, besides a lot of the other things that you said. So after a truly wonderful panel, I mean, exciting, inspirational, vast diversity in subjects, and you know, something that gave us a brief insight into what must be happening in the parliament itself. This is the exciting time now where we get to ask questions. So I will do a brief round of questions. Sorry, 1 minute. I'll do a brief round of questions and then throw the floor open to the audience. I'm actually going to focus my first question on Rajiv Gowdaji. He has a flight to catch. And I think it's important to hear him out in a bit more detail. So Rajiv, the question that really I'd like to pose to you on behalf of everyone in the audience is that clearly the Indian economy is looking strong. I mean, 7% growth, fastest growing economy, we're looking strong. Despite this optimistic outlook, we do have deep-rooted problems. And this is, I think, number one, a persistent development challenge, jobless growth, inadequate infrastructure. And directionally, I know we're doing a lot of things right, but what do you think are the top three priorities that we should focus on to ensure equitable, appropriate, and futuristic growth?
I think we need to look at where that inequity is. One part of that inequity is the rural-urban divide, and that partly comes from agrarian distress, the lack of facilities, education, healthcare, a variety of services in rural India. If that 50% of our population were better educated, were healthier, and able to fulfill their own potential even more, you'd be able to add
but,
to
but
prosperity.
But how? I think we all agree. What are the three steps?
I'm getting there. Even in my speech there, I basically talked, I'm a technology optimist. Just like the mobile phone transformed India from that waiting for 2 years for a telephone line to one where we have 1 billion connections today, I'm hopeful that we will find technological solutions that, you know, will ensure better healthcare access so that we have healthier people, that education platforms also will change, and that we will be able to create a leveler playing field. When you have that, you have more, you've invested in human capital. That's one part. Well, then that human capital needs to be, sort of encouraged to be entrepreneurial in different ways. So there are many, many gaps in the institutional frameworks, whether in rural India or urban India, that we need to fill. And that's another area, I think, where governments and across party lines, we would be able to agree that these, whether, for example, financial inclusion, right? During our time, we took bank accounts, bank branches to habitations of 2,000 and more. This government has taken it now such that every individual has a bank account. When you have your own account, when there's money in that, and when you're learning to be economically independent and confident, then you will be able to do so much more. And where you are left behind, the subsidies that you might need will also come directly there. So there are many transitions like this that we are moving forward with. But otherwise, there are still numerous infrastructural innovations that we need. For example, if you look at, again, sticking to agrarian distress, it's a wonder to me why we don't have enough storage facilities, value addition facilities, things like that, market linkage facilities. The ENAM, we started that in Karnataka, it's now expanded nationally, has been able to provide more wealth to the farmer, right? But there are other new, urbanization is the other force that's moving forward inexorably. But urbanization brings with it demand that can be fulfilled by rural India. Demand for eggs, demand for milk, demand for meat, demand for fruits and vegetables, right? And these things can make a huge difference, again, if we can find a way to ensure that some of the in-between stages are reduced. So these are just one set of, directions in which you can make growth more inclusive and address those who are left behind. Mm-hmm. See, if we don't address those who are left behind, you're going to see agitations, you're going to see unrest, you're going to see instability, which comes in the way of everything else as well. So you must, and I would appeal to you, when we quickly label something as a populist measure, think about what those measures are. Do they represent our moral commitment to those left behind, or are they an investment in our own security and stability, that we are ensuring that they are not going to go out there and agitate and bring down, set the streets on fire? So these are some of the questions that come to mind. But one thing, amongst the questions that you had up front, and I'm thinking about Pinaki's statement about, we won't pass any more bills in the House, I can't make those predictions myself. But in the last few years, if any bill has gone through, it's because we all have agreed on it, right? And we've passed constitutional amendments, multiple ones, even when the ruling party is not in the majority in the Rajya Sabha. None of this would happen if we didn't all have India's interests at our heart, and if we didn't believe that by working together, that's the only way we can take things forward. So I do hope that whichever government is in place today, whichever government will, whichever will come in 2019, we will make sure that we work across in a fairly harmonious way and so ensure that the Indian interest is paramount.
That promise of bipartisan behavior,
multipartisan
behavior, and making sure that appropriate bills pass through, lead me to one question. I was actually hoping to have a quick rapid-fire round with everybody, but before Gowdaji goes away, let me ask this one really rapid question.
Sure.
On a scale of 1 to 10, what would you give yourselves as parliamentarians, all of you, and how much of what you discuss in there really impacts us out there?
I don't know. I'd give ourselves a 7 or something like
seven,
that.
A 7, okay. You're close to distinction.
I must be a hard grader a professor. But I think that there's so many positive measures that we've brought in place. And ultimately, the job of government, look, companies will harness innovation, unleash all kinds of new energies in the marketplace. But there are inequalities that you also flagged, and part of our job, ultimately, even if everything else is done, we divest all the public sector undertakings, etc., we will still have a job of ensuring that there is a social safety net, that people's, that equity is
and our
ensured.
Social development index is focused on.
Improve and things like that. So we have a very, very solid, crucial mission in this country going forward.
And so finally, would you feel that we're on the right path, we're doing everything that needs to, we can just stay on this path and we'll be fine? Or would you tweak anything? What's the one, two things you could tweak?
Oh, I'd change the party in office.
We
have an alternative for
so
you.
So we promised to remain multi-partisan, so we're not talking about that. So at a policy level, what would you change?
See, throughout, right from 1991 to now, the broad trajectory of liberalization, opening up of the markets, has been followed by different governments, regardless of ideology.
Right.
While we accuse the Modi Sarkar of, changing, being a name-changing government, taking our policies and adopting them, it's actually a fact of, like an Aadhaar or a GST or something like that. It's basically, a tribute to the fact that ultimately there are a certain set of measures that the country needs to adopt.
So we're on the right track.
Yeah, I think we're on the right track. We have a long way to go, and we shouldn't get derailed by issues related to identity politics, to whose religion is more important than the others, and what people eat. We should emphasize that we are a free India, and freedom means freedom of many, 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 many dimensions.
That's
right.
Superb.
Thank you so much,
Ms. Gaurav. So with this, let's give him a big hand.
Okay.
He needs to leave. Thank you so much for being here with us.
I'm a substitute, so I have had to just find a way to make it here. And thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. So the no, we need it for you. We need the mic for you. But the certificate is yours. So Dineshji, that was a perfect segue into the fact that you have spoken about a new India which is focused on education, which is focused on knowledge. It's focused on awareness of who we are as a people. It's rooted in our value system. So what would you do differently from what's happening now?
Well, there's nothing you have to do differently.
Okay.
You have to understand.
Anurag loves what you said.
No, you have to understand your strength.
Okay.
And somewhere down the line, we are missing that. And why are we missing that?
Please tell us.
Because our narrative has become very negative. And I'm sorry to say, even if you go to Parliament, both the sides, if you saw today, one side saying, Tum chor hai, this side saying, Tum chor hai. Hum sab chor hai. There was a movie called Hum Sab Chor Hain. This is not India. Come on, yaar. So when you say that, are you doing things all right? I don't know about us, but FICCI is doing things all right.
Thank you. We appreciate that.
And you can clap because there is no GST on clapping. I am absolutely convinced that this is era of Indians. May not be India. Algorithm, big data, artificial intelligence. What else is left? Whether it's your health, whether it's education, I think it's a revolution. I think we are into the most interesting period in our lifetime. I don't think so this period was ever there. So can you imagine the connectivity? Amazing connectivity. It's just, you have to think what you want to do and that will happen.
Absolutely.
And that's where our strength, and who's making this happen? Indians.
Indians
believe
abroad.
Me, I am so proud to be an Indian. And we can do it. And the problem is we are not doing it.
Okay.
And that's where the frustration is. And this is where we need to obviously sit down together and understand that we are not permanent. What is permanent is change. And what is certain is death. So we all just sitting here are not going to be remaining permanent in our chairs. So we need to do whatever is right for India. And I think this is where FICCI can play a role which can get us together like you have done it today. Look, we are not fighting today, are we?
No, you're not.
So that's the... I tell you, I'm just so proud. You best of instructors are Indians. You look at... You know, Satyam, Shivam, Sundaram, all these three big companies, mm-hmm. all headed by Indians. And I have no doubt that very soon you'll have a president of America of Indian origin. That's the strength. Realize. Please realize. Okay. And that's where I am very optimistic.
So we're truly
inspired. You look at our cricket team.
Absolutely.
IPL, they come from villages.
Right.
So all we have to do is give them the opportunity. And let's get out of this GDP measure. I personally feel it's all obsolete. The way our education system is obsolete. So, if you have a village, which is very common example given, and there are 100 people, and one person in the village has 100 cars, Mercedes. So, per capita car of Mercedes would be highest in that village. Other 99% may not have anything. So understand the GDP figures are obsolete. You need to distribute. And for that, you require a robust distribution system. And that again comes through transportation. And my old portfolio of railway ministry. Unless and until you have a robust freight system, you can't make it. Your food will never be cheap. You need a robust, and we can do it. We don't need any technology. We don't really require a bullet technology from Japan. I mean, what is... It's good. And I'm not on politics about it. We can... All is this. We can do it. And let's do it. That's about it.
And your time starts now. We got that. Okay. So, thank you so much. Pinaki, there are 100 things that need to be changed, and very often the country points back to the judicial system or the law system, whether it's land acquisition is difficult and therefore we can't put up industries. Farmers have small holdings and therefore we can't use modern methodologies. There are various aspects of the law. At a wide-ranging environment, if there was a systemic change to be looked at, what are the top three priorities that you believe the future India should have to enhance and strengthen our judicial system, yet remove some of the curtailing methodologies of the current law?
Look, as far as the judicial system per se is concerned, let me candidly say that this has been one of the more less than satisfying periods as far as judicial reform is concerned and as far as judicial appointments are concerned. I know some numbers are bandied about, but I know for a fact that every single high court in this country today is functioning at less than 50% strength. It's inexplicable. It's not as if there are not enough good people. There has obviously been a kind of a face-off between the judiciary and the executive, which is now gradually getting sorted out. But otherwise, over the past 2 years, I think the situation in terms of appointments, both to the High Court, at one point the Supreme Court had 12 vacancies, which is absolutely extraordinary in the history of India. So without a robust judicial system, you will not be able to, and by robust judicial system, I don't mean just a court system. I also mean the arbitration, the alternate dispute redressal mechanism. You are not going to get investment from abroad. In fact, you will have flight of investment from India, which is what we have seen. A number of our very, very fine industrialists are taking their flight of capital out of India. They're setting up massive plants all over the world rather than expanding in India. And that's a hard fact. I don't think that can be argued about. I just want to say one thing. I'm sorry that Mr. Goda left. And this is something that I want to emphasize about. I think as far as a lot of this is to do with legislation. Pardon me. And I think the quality of legislation in India has suffered partly because of what I call, unfortunately, the cowbelt politics of India, which can get very fit, both fissiparous as well as extremely vituperative. The dialogue has coarsened the entire political dialogue has really coarsened over the years, and that has now translated to the coarsening of the dialogue at the lower level. So you see that at the street level, in your just your regular road rage that you have to encounter on a daily basis.
What should we do? What do you, you know, the realities?
I really believe the time has come where, when the two largest political parties are both, both the Prime Minister as well as Mrs. Gandhi, are both committed to women's reservation. I think women's reservation, this is the need of the hour. It can be done now because it's been passed in the Rajya Sabha. The problem is with two or three of these parties, I don't want to name them, but they're from UP and Bihar, who have absolutely no presence at the moment. In UP, Samajwadi Party has barely 5 MPs, BSP has no MP at all. So with these two major political parties, and I'm sure Mamata Didi is of course going to back it, Mr. Naveen Patnaik has had the Orissa Assembly pass a unanimous resolution that we must pilot this. If, as Mr. Goda said, there is appetite for legislation, this is a seminal piece of legislation. It should be brought in immediately, and you will see the refinement of both dialogue, the refinement of the legislative process is going to come about, because inherently, I believe, getting more women, their participation in parliament and in the legislatures of India is going to be a refinement of both the polity as well as of, you know, the entire legislative process. So when you said I stand for women, I truly do. I actually believe that if Mr. the Prime Minister, and he will be hailed forever, I'll tell you, he will be remembered as an absolute revolutionary. If he's able to bring in this piece of legislation now, it can easily be passed in half a day. It doesn't need any, you know, too much debate, because on paper, every party is for it. So all you need is the will to bring it on a bipartisan basis, and it can become law tomorrow. So I believe this is the need of the hour, and I hope Anurag conveys to the, you know, powers that be, and he of course is one of the worst cases of a waste of talent in a government which is so shorn of bench strength and so shorn of talent. To have a man like Anurag Thakur sit out of the cabinet, in my opinion, is criminal waste of good talent. But then,
what a backhand compliment that is.
This is their party politics, so I don't want to say much, yeah. But at least, you know, he's the chief whip of the party. He should convey to his party bosses that the time has really come for women's reservation in parliament.
I can see that both Geetha and Anurag have quickly picked up their mics, but I would request that history records the fact that it was at a FICCI AGM that all members of the parliament who represented the larger house today said that women's reservation is critical. And I think we should give them a big hand for this one. So as I stated earlier, FICCI is absolutely, totally pro-women. And it's a great platform on which you have made this statement. But Anurag, I know you're dying to respond, but I'm going to give you the last word. And I give this thing to Geetha. And say, Geetha, in light of this, I know that you would love to talk about women's reservation in politics. But I think that we really want to understand women's empowerment in entrepreneurship. We have with us in the audience representatives of Flo. We have a few women representatives, but we have many gentlemen here who are today bringing in the next generation of women into their businesses and into their houses. But we also realize that 50% of the population needs to do more and can do more to accelerate our growth rate. So your quick views on women entrepreneurship.
First of all, I appreciate many women who have been sitting here as heads of different companies. And I feel that more women should come into it. I feel that a lot of women are now coming up with startup companies. And when women come up with startup companies, not only women, I feel that the procedures at the state or the central government should be simplified and they should be encouraged to come up with more startup companies. And there should be a single window clearance, because clearances are the things that are actually dragging issues longer. So I feel that more women should come into politics, should become entrepreneurs as well as should come into politics. I want to say one thing when it comes.
What are the steps?
Yeah.
Do you think, like, I think Pinky Reddy is in the audience, Flo and FICCI together came together to create a women's entrepreneurship park. I think that's a model which can be replicated across every state. That was done in Telangana. I believe there are other. So what are the steps you think in the future India to encourage women?
I think this should start from the universities itself,
okay.
Particularly the girls who are more interested in entrepreneurship, so to start up with a new company. So it has to be directly taken from the colleges, because they are fresh and they have got good knowledge about what they want to do. So I have seen so many ladies who wanted to start up companies who have fresh thoughts. So such thoughts have to be improved, and even financing for such things. It also requires a lot of financial assistance.
So
I think FICCI will come forward and encourage such women entrepreneurs who are actually having innovative ideas.
So focus, financing, and a lot more encouragement. We
encouragement.
Got you. Thank you,
and,
Geetha.
And yeah. One more thing I would like to say, women should have an organized movement. When there is a small deviation of SCST Act, the entire country stood together and the parliament was forced to pass an act, pass a law. So I feel that women are not having that sort of organized movement. I think women should come up with an organized movement. Then only it is possible that women reservation bill also will be passed in the Lok Sabha. Thank you.
Interesting. So Anurag, it's all yours. I think across a range of topics we've spoken, but besides some of the answers that you want to, you reference something which is a subject which is very dear to all of us, that the new India can only awake and arise when we have tapped the power of technology. So you referenced artificial intelligence, new age economy, the knowledge industry. So besides the other comments you make, can you please specifically tell us, do you think we've done enough? Whether it's data protection, whether it's startup culture, and what do you think we need to do to ensure that we have a lot more unicorns than we have today?
Thank you, Sangita. I agree with my other colleagues. And we supported the Women Reservation Bill in the 15th Lok Sabha. BJP has been supportive. If you look at Bharatiya Janata Party organizational structure, we have reservation for women in that as well, as far as the office bearers are concerned. If you look at the Panchayati Raj system in the Bharatiya Janata Party rule states, we have 50% reservation for women. We have already implemented that. But do you think the empowerment means only in as a legislature? The real empowerment has been given by Mr. Modi. If you look at the sanitation before 2014, it was 50%. It is more than 95% today. If you look at the LPG cylinder distribution, it used to be 53%. It is 95% today. If you look at the education level, if I go back to my constituency, in any annual function, out of the top 10, 7 are girl child. So it is not merely by the reservation you do it, but society overall has to do a lot of things for the upbringing and empowerment of the woman. Look at Modi's 2014 cabinet, it was 25% women. Look at the Lok Sabha speaker. If you look at the previous chairpersons of various banks till last year, most of the banks were headed by women. So they didn't come up through reservation. It was their ability that they came up. Though I am in favor of women reservation as far as the parliament is concerned, if you look at the Mudra loan beneficiaries, out of 130 million, 65% are women. So this is another way of empowering women by providing them the basic facilities to come up to the ladder.
Completely agree. I think there has
been as far as the technology is concerned.
And then we have some questions from the audience.
You see, the things changes from time to time as far as the technology is concerned, from 2G to 4G. Now we are looking at the 5G. The telcos will say that they have to look at the net neutrality again as far as the 5G comes in. But if you look at the common man's need, we need broadband connectivity at the villages. That is why the Digital India is very, very important, where we have already reached out to more than 100,000 panchayats in the rural India. And it will be completed by the April 2019, reaching out to 250,000 panchayats. That is eventually going to help and empower the common man in the villages. As I earlier said, whether it is e-healthcare, e-education or otherwise, all these are linked to the technology. We see at the grassroots level, there is a shortage of quality teachers. But with the e-education, you can come over that by providing the smart classrooms in the villages. Whatever a student is getting a quality education in Delhi or in Mumbai, they will be able to get that there. Now, coming back to healthcare sector, I don't know whether you have assessed it or not. How many who come to Apollo, Fortis or Max hospitals can afford your healthcare services? They go below poverty line after coming to your hospitals.
No.
They have to raise loans.
They have insurance coverage, you know that.
And nobody mentioned that Mr. Modi came out with that by providing the health coverage to 500 million people of 5 lakh rupees.
Absolutely.
I have started a program. You know, what is New India? Let me just share it with you. I'll take just 2 minutes. I've started 2-3 programs. Everyone talks about the drugs menace. What next? I started a program in my constituency called Star Khel Mahakumbh. 20,000 players participated in the first go. 100,000 will be participating by the March 2019. Involvement in sports will make them involved in play fields rather than in drugs. Now, when we talk about healthcare, they get to know about the disease at the very later stage.
Too late.
I started in my constituency called Sansad Mobile Swasthya Seva, SMS Seva. It's called Aspatal. We are close to reach out to 50,000 mark in less than 6 months' time, doing the lipid profile to various other basic tests, providing free medicines and all that to everyone. Now, the meritorious students, I'm taking them as a Sansad Bharat Darshan program. 40 girl child, they went to Bangalore and Pune for more exposure. But none from the industry come forward to help. You know, I'm saying it in a FICCI program. I said it in one of your CSR program as well. Whatever outstanding programs we do, only very limited companies come forward to handhold and implement it at the grassroots level.
So let's talk offline about that one. I think we have one or two questions from the audience. So if we get that quickly, please, Dr. Lal, right there. And then I'm coming to you, sir. And we're going to be really brief. We need to wrap in 5 to 7 minutes.
You know, we've all praised the Chinese way of functioning, that they are far ahead of us, et cetera, et cetera. And one of the things which I have noticed why the Chinese are far advanced in India is that they have a CEO kind of a mind frame in their politicians. And it has been excessively talked about and written about, that their selection from local level to the highest level is based on performance. So my question is to Geetha ma'am. Ma'am, in nearly 10 years ago, we read that the Lok Sabha functioned in India for only 66 days as compared to the British House of Commons, which worked for 144 days. So how can we make the Lok Sabha work more?
Actually, really I want to say that this Lok Sabha has functioned much, much fairly better than the other Lok Sabhas, because we need to introspect on this. The politicians who have been coming into power right now are being the representatives who are elected. They are more enthusiastic to represent the people's problems. When they are enthusiastic to actually attend to problems, the functioning also is increasing, and we have seen this parliament, this Lok Sabha, was functioning till night 11 o'clock sometimes. We have done, actually this parliament, this Lok Sabha has done extremely well, except for the two last...
last monsoon okay? session.
Last we had monsoon sessions.
118% business in Lok Sabha, 87% in Rajya Sabha.
And I believe...
Yeah, we thank you.
We thank you. It's all together.
Kindly run the house so from Monday onwards.
We have actually done very well during this session.
And please keep up your record. Your session has just started. Yes. So let's have a good session. Our next question, please.
I'm Arvinder Singh Brara, Chairman and Managing Director of Mantech Consultants. Okay. You know, we have seen that discipline plays a very important part in a nation's success. Japan and Germany became superpowers because they somehow could get their people to be disciplined. So my question is, how do we get through the parliamentarians and through other social leaders instill a greater sense of discipline in our people, whether it be on the road, whether it be dealing with women, whether it be Dinesh, doing the responsibility? So I'll appreciate a response.
I think it's a fantastic question and observation. That's the basis. And to have you can't have Sashan without Anusashan. And you can only have discipline if there is rule of law. If you think that the guy who's somebody, related to somebody and knows the cop, he has a separate rule, or a member of parliament has totally a different rule, unless and until you have the rule of law for everybody. And this is, again, I go back where I started. The value system which we got from our parents, our gurus. This is where, again, spirituality comes. A huge picture of the country and concern for others. When somebody is walking across the door, it's a natural thing to hold the door. So concern has to be for the other guy. But I agree totally, without discipline, we cannot progress.
I'm sorry, I'm down to my last question here. Please go ahead.
My question is to Anurag ji. In your speech, you referred to the demographic dividend, the power of youth. I'm on the board of NSDC, and every day we struggle, we brainstorm. We are skilling millions. Yesterday, newspaper said about a million youth have been skilled under various programs. We are making them employable. But actually, they are not getting jobs. So what is your vision on that? And second, quick one, since you come from Himachal and your background is agriculture, why this government has done very well on MSP? They almost doubled the procurement prices. And we know the inflation is so low, but that is also hurting our farmers. And we all know farm loan waiver is not a solution. Although after the political debacle of yesterday, the newspapers predicted the government may go for loan waivers. So what is your 1 or 2 point agenda that how we can help this agriculture stress? These two questions.
I think the question before us is, if we keep making fake promises of loan waiver, look at what happened in Punjab. Congress, despite after 2 years, could not give the loan waiver. And the government have only 2,500 crore rupees for the development work. How do the state progress then? Look at Karnataka. They promised, but they could not implement. Right. Even they don't have funds for the development work. So we have to be, you know, very practical in making some promises. We should not make false promises to be in power.
Who holds who accountable for this?
The people.
Because the cycle of 5 years is very long. By then, a whole state economy could.
Do you want to change it to 3 years?
No, I want a different way to validate promises.
See, the issue is, it depends from government to government, state to state.
It costs too much to have it in such a short cycle. Sorry, go ahead.
Look at the size of India with 1.3 billion people. Nothing will be practical less than 5 years. You need some time to implement your decisions. You know, we make laws. We make the strongest law as far as possible after the Nirbhaya rape case. Did the rape stop? I think it's the implementation is the key. When we lack in the implementation, whatever rule or law is, that is, we are unable to achieve what we are. Look at India today. You know, like if I make any comment against judiciary, they will call me to the court. But a retired judge says, a Supreme Court judge has been remote controlled. Now he can say that, I and you can't say that.
No, I think the most powerful statement on which we should end this evening is that implementation is key.
I just want to, on the loan waiver, I think we have to also differentiate between NPAs of the bank. I don't think so, because of farmers, there are bank NPAs. And please understand, the farm sector is really, really in distress. If the farmers do not have the earning and spending power, industries cannot do very well. So when we talk about loan waiver, why should there be a loan? Farmers should earn enough so that they don't have to beg.
Absolutely.
Skilled manpower, I just want to address to Mr. Sani's question. Skilled manpower.
Yes.
Because if you look at Germany, they have dual education system where industry also plays an important role with education.
True. Vocation.
In India, there is a gap between the industry's need and our education system. That need to be bridged by the involvement of the industry. And I think that is very important as far as the skill development is concerned, and I'm glad that you are on the board. But at the same time, ultimately, it is the industry who has to give them jobs, whether they have to become entrepreneurs or they have to seek for jobs.
So perfectly agree with you. And on that note, I think we should thank our entire panel for their tremendous insights, for their energy, for their passion, and for their commitment to their country. Anuragji rightly referred this back to industry. So I want to conclude by quoting from Swami Vivekananda, which is what Dinesh ji started with, and which is really a brief, quick peep into what you're going to have at the next session. And this quote says, "We are the makers of our own fate. The wind is blowing. Those vessels whose sails are unfurled catch it and go forward on their own way. But which do not have their sails furled do not catch the wind. Is it then the fault of the wind?" So as industry, we need to be ready. We need to understand where the wind is blowing, have our sails open, so that the policies that these gentlemen make, we are ready to make sure that industry grows and catches the wind. Thank you all for a wonderful session. Can we? No. We mean country gains. Country wins. Please give them all a big hand. Thank you all so much for being a wonderful audience.